When we talk.
Were you from Paris?
From Barcelona.
Barcelona? Oh, Espanol? Espanol, hablamos Espanol, amigos.
Question for him, please.
But I'll give you, I'll give you a way.
I will like to talk.
Espanol? I hablo un poquito.
I'll try to talk.
You speak English. I think you speak better English than I do Spanish, yeah?
Yeah.
Tres conejos en el
mundo.
It was an old boys' school. We didn't have anyone look like you.
You went to school with George Harrison, no?
Yeah, he went to school with me.
The Lipa, L.
That's right, Lipa, yeah.
I have a question about
this.
How do you feel?
Sure, yeah, yeah.
I have some musical questions.
Yeah.
And some about ecology.
Yeah, good. None about sex, I hope.
No, nothing.
Thank goodness for that. It was a close call. Yeah, I don't know about things like that, luckily. Luckily. No, no, it's Madonna. No, I don't know anything about that. No, no, just Madonna. She knows all about it. She's cornered the market anyway.
Sobre todo, no
tanques.
Yeah!
Ahora, ahora?
Make your question about Barcelona.
Sí.
Ahora, en general, momento.
Barcelona. I always had a pen pal there, you know. What's his name? Juan Rodriguez. There must be a million Juan Rodriguez's in my last class. It's like John Smith or something, isn't it? It was, you know, when I was at school, we used to write to each other. I don't know what happened to him. But he knew I was in the Beatles, he wrote to me. Probably dead or something. So, how are you? Okay? Tocando?
Uh-huh. Okay. 5 seconds.
5, 4.
I say good night because this will be in the night.
The night, okay.
It's a program the night, okay?
Okay.
Okay, well, good night, Mr. McCarthy. McCartney, how
hola,
are you?
Hola, Magda. Buenas tardes. Noches.
Buenas noches.
Noches, okay.
Buena nit in Catalan.
Thank you very much.
You know, people in Barcelona are impatiently waiting for you because this will be the first time you give a concert in a stadium since you came there with the Beatles in the 60s.
Yeah.
When, with an exception, the concert you give to release the unplugged rock and roll record.
That's right, the Celeste Club.
But it goes for the happy few who get lucky enough to get a ticket.
It was a small one, yeah.
Now, why did you choose Barcelona of all European cities?
It's not really up to me. No, really, it isn't. I always ask the promoter and I say, you know, where do you think we ought to play? And so I leave it up to him, really. But I like Barcelona very much. When I was in school, I used to write to a guy in Barcelona. We used to be pen pals. And he would write in Spanish and I would try, because I studied Spanish in school. Not very well, but I did study it. And I would write back in English. But I don't know if we ever find him. It's Juan Rodriguez, I think his name was, but there's lots of them, right? 500 million Juans. Hey, Juan, how you doing? All right, amigo.
And what made you decide to include Barcelona now in the present tour?
Well, as I say, you know, I like it, but it's mainly the promoter's job that. I just talk with the promoter and I say, you know, I'd like to go to Spain, I'd like to go to Italy, I'd like to go to Germany. And he just looks, he talks with other promoters and they just look at what is maybe the best place to go. And so I leave it up to him. So, but it's a beautiful city, you know, what I'd like to go is see some of the tourist things like the Gaudi architecture.
You know very, very much things about Barcelona?
No. Not many, but one or two.
One or two. The other time you were there with in Celeste, you know, in the small local.
Sí.
You hear the well. What do you think about all the versions we have made in Spain about Beatles songs? Do you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's always good for me. It's always a great honor if anybody does my song. You know, because if you write a song, it really doesn't matter if a little child does it. It's a great honor. So I like things being translated and being done by other artists. So it's good for me.
You know the Manolos. You know the Manolos version of All My Loving?
Yeah.
What do you think about it?
It's good.
It's good.
That's good, yeah, sure. Do you like it?
Yeah.
Do you like it? She likes it. Okay, Manolos, hey.
Well, some critics say that Off the Ground is the more Beatles sounding record you have made after you broke off with the band.
Mm.
Do you think that is true?
That's maybe true. When we first broke up with the Beatles, we didn't want to do anything that sounded like the Beatles, so we tried to be very different. But I think as time went by, I think we all understood that it was our sound. And if we just left it behind, then everyone else would just take it and people wouldn't realize that it was ours, you know. So I like Beatle records, you know.
Me too.
Yeah. Well, you know, I like them and I have a nostalgia for them. I like the simplicity of them. I like the sound. So now I'm not really frightened to make something that sounds a bit like it, because it's really, now it's a Paul McCartney record that sounds like a Beatle record. So that's okay for me. You know, I'm not so shy about doing that anymore. It's a good sound, you know. And I think now a lot of people also are coming back to 60s style music, yeah? A lot of the younger bands are interested.
It's the following question I want to ask you. This week has just appeared the Blue and Red record, the compilation.
Yeah.
In compact disc. Mm. And new generations still love Beatles music.
Mm.
Maybe it can be in the top of the hit parade.
Yeah.
What do you feel about this?
I feel very good. Let's hope so. It's a good tribute that people still want to hear our music, because it was 30 years ago today. You know, it's a long time ago. So I just feel good that people still want to hear it, because the opposite would be that people didn't want to hear it. They didn't like the music. There was a new kind of music in that had totally wiped out our music. Whereas the opposite seems to be true. You know, people are still interested in that. And I think some of the songs, because we do them in the show, we do some songs like Penny Lane and things. And it's interesting to listen to the words, because I wrote them quite a long time ago. But I think they're still good. They still work now, you know. It's not, some songs, you make songs and they're so simple that they don't work after 30 years. You know, some people's work doesn't sound so good. But I'm happy that ours, I think, still sounds good. And they've made it sound a little better with digital. I mean, I don't know if it's better. I haven't heard it, actually.
No.
They don't play them to me.
Yeah. And do you think Beatles are classical?
I like them. Good group. Good group. Good rock and roll band, yeah. Now, it's after the Beatles broke up, we were all a little bit angry with each other. So we tried to sort of say, right, you know, oh, we're not going to do anything. But of course, you know, as time goes by, you think, oh, that was great. Or you hear a song on the radio, you think, oh, I like that one, right? And so now we do them in the show, you know. And when you're in Germany here and you do something like back in the USSR, because they're so near to the Soviet Union, it's still an important song. I mean, when Billy Joel goes to Russia, he plays that song. So I don't see why I shouldn't.
Oh. Well, the Beatles not only made a musical revolution, but a revolution in the way of life of young people all over the world.
Mm.
Do you feel responsible of the changes in the 60s?
I think if we hadn't have done it, somebody else would have. It just had, we were like the spokesman for our generation. We were not the only people who thought like that, but we were the most public, and we had this fame, early fame as young guys. So people would come with television cameras and say, what do you think, what do you think? And things like, we'd go to America and they said, the first thing they said, don't mention Vietnam War. And we said, why not? You know, a lot of our American friends are having to go there. We think it's a bad war. Why? What's America doing there? Shh, don't mention it. Well, we did, you know, because we're honest guys. And they said, well, what do you think about Vietnam? We said, we think it's a bad war. And I think all of this changed people's attitudes, you know. And in Spain, you still had Franco.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it was quite a tight regime. I remember going to Spain
then.
And it was, the grown-ups had control. Young people, you know, girls were still being chaperoned out. It was peasant. It was like a peasant country, beautiful country, and we loved it. You know, it was very beautiful, great history. But the young people we met didn't seem very liberated. But now, it's very different, you know. And I think if we've had some small part in that, then I think that's a good thing. I think liberation is always better than prison. Always. Yeah.
Do you think that in the 19th we need some radical changes, a kind of revolution like in the 60s?
Well, you know, I think it is changing. I think it is changing all the time. I think you don't stop this kind of change. I think it's like in China now. We see they're repressed. You know, they put down the Tiananmen Square thing, but they didn't really, you know. That's going to break one of these days. It's going to take time. I think the revolution is a slow revolution. I'm interested in certain ideas that are changing, you know, certain things that we promote here. For instance, animal rights, we're hot on now, which is becoming a little bit more of a new issue because people say, animals, what's that got to do with anything? It's nothing to do with humans, you know, we can eat them, use them as we want. I think we can learn. I think the human race is still very young. And as you say, there was a big revolution in the 60s. I hope it's going to go on into the 90s. We've got ecology. You know, this hole in the sky is not a good idea. No. And we've got to close this. And I think everyone knows. So we come on the tour and we play a lot of music. We have a good time. We have a party. But we always try and give a little bit for people to think about. Because if you can get the young people to think about it, even to just talk about it, then when they grow up, maybe they tell their kids, hey, you know. And I think the message stays. So we promote things like animal rights, vegetarianism, you know, because we've been vegetarians for about 20 years. You know, we don't try and lecture people on it, but we just say, look, if you're fans of our music, you might want to know what we think as well. You know, like you say, the Beatles, it wasn't just the music. It was how we thought. It was what we thought about Vietnam, about Franco, about all this stuff going on. We thought, not too good, you know? And we said it. And then, I mean, I'm not saying we were responsible for it, but our generation was responsible for stopping things like the Vietnam War. So I think it'll carry on. I hope it will anyway. Because if it doesn't, we're finished. Yeah? Don't you think? If nobody does anything about the planet, we'll blow it up. You know, and there's only us can do it. There's only the humans can do it. But I have a lot of faith. I think it's changing in a good way.
Yeah. Do you believe that the change...
Change is battery. Okay. Batteria. Yeah. You all right?
We have how many time?
So are you the hostess of the show?
The hostess, okay.
You're the presenter.
And
of the show.
I work in another kind of program, ecological program. It's a little program about 3 minutes, and we talk about all these questions.
Current
ecological
affairs,
questions, the changing individual attitudes is my following question. Good.
I think it's important. Yeah. It's good.
For example, okay.
Why has he got a better battery than him?
We go on.
Yeah.
Okay.
My camera's got a good battery.
My camera is.
My camera's great. Doing great, mate. Yeah, okay.
Oh.
No.
Poor of me.
Oh.
Pobre
Nina. Okay.
Do you believe that the change in the present way of life must start changing individual attitudes, think globally, act
locally?
Yeah. As friends of the earth?
I thought that was a good thing that they said. That's why we use it in our program, because I think, you know, we can think globally, we can think, what about the hole in the ozone layer? But we can't go up there and stop it. That has to be a government. We can't do it, you can't do it, I can't do it. But we can think locally, you know, so that at home, you know, you can get into things like recycling. And all those little things then help change people's attitudes. And when the government sees that people want this badly enough, then they have to do it. If these days, someone was talking, they say, in these days, they don't have leadership. They have followership. Do you understand that in Spanish? You know, because the government just waits to see what the people want, and then they do it. So we've got to talk up now. It's to us to talk up, you know, it's the people. And I see myself just as one of the people, you know, not as any great leader. So what we try and do is do it in our own lives, and then people maybe say, well, what you're doing is okay, you know, you look all right for 51 or something. I said, well, you know, maybe you consider a vegetarian diet. Maybe it's not a bad idea. But I think you just have to do it yourself. You can't tell the world to do it. So we try and do it by setting an example, you know.
Has your own life changed in this line, no?
Yeah, quite a lot, yeah.
What kind of things? Recycling, you have said?
Yeah, recycling, yeah. Just really speaking up, you know, talking. I think as we learn more, just from television, from news programs, you know, you get an opinion. And the government doesn't always listen to it, but I have an opinion on, you know, most things. There's too many things to discuss right now.
And your opinion is important. You're a famous person.
Well, you know, I feel responsible because, you know, people do sometimes listen to me, like you. You know, they will listen to you if you're on television. And you know there's intelligent people watching. You're not the only intelligent person there, but you're the voice for those intelligent people. And I think that's important, you know. I think it's a good freedom. I think things like television and communication are what will change the world. Because, you know, for instance, you think about Russia when they had that Chernobyl, the nuclear explosion. Mm-hmm. In the old days, we would have never found out about it. But now they have television. And the minute we saw those pictures, we all knew. And the Russians couldn't say, what explosion? They had to say, yeah, we have one. Or Ethiopia. When we saw those pictures coming back of the starving children of Somalia, they can't, their government can't say, no, it's not true, it's, don't worry. We now see it for ourselves in our own houses. And I think that's what causes the change now.
Do you think the world can survive?
Minute, my camera will be better than yours. When I've refreshed after this refreshing pause. Okay.
Magda, como ves?
It's in the same way. I don't know if you are repeating the same always, but and do you think the world can survive with the present rate of development, overuse, overexploitation, and the imbalance between West and Third World?
I think, you know, that's the difficult problem. I say to people, if you solve the world's problems at the moment, what have we got? We got war, AIDS, cancer. I mean, that's just three, and there's many more. If you solve all of those, there's one problem that doesn't go away, which is overpopulation. More and more people on this little globe, you know. So I think we've got to look for new ways. And this is actually probably my most important reason for vegetarianism. Is people just think, oh, it's just a diet. But it actually feeds more people. You can feed 20 times the amount of people. And I think that, in the next century, will probably be the reason why people may go that way. That's my theory. I think, you know, you're going to have too many people. And but what people do is they take the grain that's grown in the fields and then feed it to a cow and then eat the cow. It's uneconomical. So I think that's a very good reason for vegetarianism. And people used to think it was terrible too, but I mean, we eat great. If you eat here in our kitchen here, the catering, you eat like at a good restaurant. You know, things have changed. People understand much better now. In fact, I have on vegetarian shoes.
Vegetarian?
Yeah.
Why?
On the cover of my new album, these shoes, Paul is live, but they're, it's non-leather, you know, so things are changing. That's not leather, but it looks like it, huh?
Yeah.
Looks very good. Doc Martens. I don't know, but it's not leather, it's like some plastic or something, you know. Okay. So, you know, I think the world's changing anyway. Things are catching up. New ideas are what'll help. If we don't have any new ideas, we just have more of the old ideas and then we blow each other up. Huh? So, yeah, I'm optimistic. I think it's good, you know, I believe that people will get it together. I believe in young people. That's who I think will do it. You know, I think the old people are maybe a little too fixed in their ways, you know.
Yeah.
I'm talking like a young person. I'm not a young person, but you know what I mean. But I do think, you know, young people are interested in this because they will inherit the planet, you know. And we need to do something. So I think when I see people at the concerts here, there's a lot of this, you know, there's a lot of this, because I think they know what I'm saying and they understand.
Come on,
people, you know, let's get it together, you know.
Then you live in a farm in Sussex with a family. You love living with a family, with a with Linda and your own children.
Mm.
But is this life compatible with a busy life of a rock star?
Yeah, well, what it is, it's the balance. It's necessary. It is compatible, yeah. Mm. But it's necessary. What we do, like after a show like tonight, we'll fly back to England and then we'll be home, wind down the windows, breathe the fresh air, you know, and relax for a day. Do nothing, just take it nice and easy in the countryside. And then we're okay, we can get back into the city and we can work. I think you need a balance. So we have it like that.
And how do you get along with your own children? You understand?
Very
the
well.
Way?
I mean, we are blessed as a family, really blessed, you know, touch wood for good luck. Touch wood, yeah? But we're really very lucky, Linda and I, because we've got four kids and they like to come with us when they can. You know, sometimes they're at school. My boy's at school today, so he couldn't come. But he would like to come, you know. And they're really great kids. They're really great kids. And even some of the things that I expected to happen, that every parent expects to happen, you always think, we must grow apart. You know, the music tastes, they must get into something like I did with my parents. You know, my dad liked Chicago, Chicago. And we liked, you know, rock and roll and stuff, you know. But our kids like a lot of what I like. I mean, my son plays a little guitar. He's very into Jimi Hendrix. So that's easy for me. And these are little surprising things, you know, when you find there isn't a big generation gap. I mean, we can talk. I couldn't talk to my father about sex.
No.
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 I said, you know, as young dad, you know, what is this thing? Shouldn't you be having a talk with me? And he said, you see those dogs in the street? Yeah. He said, well, that, no, you wouldn't know. And I couldn't get over it for years. You know, I thought, he means it. But it was his way of not talking about it. He was trying to give me a quick lesson, you know, but it put me off for years. But I can sit down with my kids and I can say, well, you know, this is this and this is this and this is what it's all about. Hopefully to give them some information so they don't go out in the world like, you know, and make a lot of mistakes, because these days with AIDS out there, you've got to know what's going on. Hmm?
Change
subject quickly.
Change.
This subject. Is a family show.
About Lennon, there is a lot of writing about your relationship after the band broke up. But do you mind tell us how was this relationship? You were good friends, weren't
yeah.
you?
Oh yeah. We were. I knew John when I was pretty young. I must have been about 16 when we met. So we were very good friends through all of that period. And then the Beatles broke up. And he went to live in New York. So we didn't see much of each other. And there were a lot of problems around then. So we used to, we'd bitch at each other. And that was sad. But the good thing was that he and I eventually made it up. I used to phone him in New York, you know, after all the arguments were over. And we got to be friends again, and it was nice. Long distance friends, but it was still friends. And I could phone him, I said, what are you doing now? He said, oh, I'm just baking some bread. I said, baking bread? Well, I've done that. You know, he said, oh, I'm just feeding the cat. He liked cats, you know. I said, well, I've got a couple of dogs. You know, we talk about ordinary things. And that brought us back together again. Because when we talked about business, it always ended up, oh, your business, my business. What are you doing? What am I doing? You know, it was crazy. Business is like that, you know, can be anyway. But it was very good, actually. It was the one good thing when he died was that we had got our friendship back together again. So I was very happy about that. Very sad about his death, of course, like everyone. It was tragic and it was one of the worst things to ever happen. But at least we'd spoken on the phone and at least we were friends. So that was a big consolation for me.
Well, I changed the subject. Last year you released a classical composition, the Liverpool Oratorium.
Mm.
Did the experience satisfy you?
Yeah, it was great. It was really good to do. I like a lot of different kinds of music. I like Indian music, I can like classical music, I can like traditional jazz, modern jazz, rock and roll, heavy metal, rap. You know, I like a lot of different kinds of music. I think there's good in every kind of music and my taste's quite wide. So I got this offer to do the orchestral piece and it was a thrill, you know, because I just sat around with my friend Carl Davis and we just wrote it over, I think, about 2 years. And then we actually sat down with the orchestra and they opened the music and they tried to play it. And we said, you know, a little bit like this. It was a great experience. I want to do it again. I'd like to do it again, but you know, I'd have to have some time. I think next year I'm going to find some time after the tour. But it was really wonderful to do because I worked with a slightly different kind of musician. You know, sort of what you call serious musicians. I mean, my musicians are pretty serious here, but that's classical. And it's very interesting, really good fun to do. And a different kind of sound for me, a little deeper, what you can get into, bigger, grander, you know, grandiose. And then when you're working with a violinist, for instance, I've only ever worked with guitar players, but you know, you can play the violin and get a little bit of this into it. So yeah, that was great. At the moment, I'm writing some piano pieces that are in the same vein, but that's the oratorio is for 300 people, just a big choir, big orchestra. These piano pieces are for just one pianist.
Classical.
It's classical, yeah. Okay. So I hope to finish those next year. But it's good, I really like to do that. It's something, I remember when I wrote Eleanor Rigby, I think I was mid-20s, and I was looking at the age of 30. You know how you do in your mid-20s? I don't know how old you are, but...
36.
36, oh, so you've done this. Mm-hmm. But you look from your mid-20s, you think, I better be doing something grown-up by the time I'm 30. You know, I've got to do something sensible and serious, you know. It's okay doing, having a laugh while you're young. And I thought, wow, you know, with Eleanor Rigby, it's slightly classical, the melody, classical orchestras use it and do it. I thought, I could be one of those guys with patches on the elbows and a sort of tweed suit and a pipe and writing music like that, you know. Well, I haven't got the jacket or the pipe, but I've got the music. Yeah, you know, it's becoming something very interesting to do. As well as performing, and maybe in the end, instead of performing, you know.
Another question, the Liverpool Institute for Performing Arts. Hmm. What are your hopes regarding this project?
Well, the first hopes were to save the building, because, you know, it's the school George Harrison and I went to, and it was falling down. The roof leaked, and so all the insides of it were getting really, it was going to fall down. Hmm. And nobody was doing anything about it, so I just wanted to save the school. Number one, I just wanted to save the school. So we eventually came up with this idea of putting a performing arts thing there. And it's going very well. There's now a roof on the building. The building's getting fixed up now. And we're hoping to open in about 1995, maybe, you know. And it will be for people aged 18-ish. So after they finish school, really. Mm-hmm. Finish their young school, they would come on like a college. And we would teach all the aspects of performing arts, like music. I might be able to teach a little bit there, you know, so that'd be interesting because I've never done that. So it'd be very interesting for me and hopefully for the students. And we'll have overseas students and local people. There'll be dance, which I won't be teaching. You'll be glad to know. I don't know. No. And there'll be theatre. But also we teach things like lighting, recording. So there's all those other jobs. You know, as someone said, to put one performer on stage, you need 30 other people for the lighting, for the management, for the production, for the recording, for all of this. And we're hoping to teach a lot of that. So I think the crossover between the artists and the artisans could be very interesting.
Okay.
You're getting signals.
One more, please. Please.
A man behind
the bushes. I have to choose about all them.
To be the last question.
Well, Beatles reunion. A message. What do you prefer? A message for people in Barcelona, for your Catalan fans?
Both? We make both questions.
I have more.
It's okay. No, we just put it to you. You'll hit me.
Okay.
So the Beatles reunion, what happened was that we're doing a TV series about the history of the Beatles, maybe 10 parts. And they're working on that now. And me, George and Ringo are helping them try and get the facts right, who we're talking about. And we do some new interviews for that. And then they go back over our career and say, you know, this was this, this is when they went to America, this is when they came here, etc. So I think it'd be an interesting series. And the idea came up along the way that maybe if, you know, in films, sometimes you need a little bit of music. If there's a little car scene going along, you need a little bit of incidental music. So I thought it might be good if me, George, and Ringo maybe made a little piece of music, maybe just an instrumental, just something simple. So we've become a little interested in that idea. Now, when I say that, people say, ah, this means the Beatles are getting together. It's not the Beatles. It's only three quarters of the Beatles. You know, the Beatles has to have John. You can't do the Beatles without John. It's a stupid idea.
Not the Beatles.
And you can't put Julian in that position. You know, some people say Julian Lennon's
John. Or Elvis Costello.
Or Elvis Costello, no way. No, I mean, you know, nothing against them, but John was John, you know, and that's the Beatles. So we'd rather keep it like that. But three of us, there would be like a mini reunion, a three quarters reunion, if the three of us get into the studio. But I'm not sure when that will happen, but that's the idea that sparked these rumors. So that's the first part of your question. And then could I say hello to Catalan? Amigos, buenas noches. Yo soy Paulo Macatnio. Hey. And habla español, naturalmente. I hope to see you in Barcelona. I'll speak in English because it's much easier for me. Hope to see you in Barcelona at our show. Be there. I want to see you all for an evening of rock and roll. Let's have a party. Okay?
Okay, very well. I have more questions. Well, okay.
Thank you
very much.
Next time when we're in Barcelona, maybe.
Next time?
Maybe.
Oh, huh? Well.
We'll see. You must talk to this man. It's Hirschhute.
Hirschhute.
I know that. Please.
This is a shower room.
There's a lot of
it?
Questions.
That's
the drain. I can't.
Probably right.
It is, I'm sure. And this is our carpet, isn't it?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Adios.
Thank you very much.
Adios. Muchachas.
Muchachas.
Mujer. Niña.
Niña.
Adios. Ciao. Hopefully, maybe see you in Barcelona, huh?
Okay.
You hold Spanish room?
I have the legals in July for you.
Yeah? See, it's fun. Speak to Jeff because, you know, it might be possible. The next round.